words that Jesus spoke during his crucifixion upon the cross. One note that for the service, the early childhood students will be singing our opening hymn. So with that, let us go ahead and rise and greet one another in the name of Christ. The congregation will stand in the invocation of the Lord. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Jesus said, "Whoever hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life."
He has not come into judgment, but has passed from death to life.
The word of the cross is folly to those who are perishing. gracious Father, during this season of Lent, we reflect upon the suffering death of our Savior and Lord, Jesus Christ. We acknowledge that it is because of our sin that he suffered, and we repent of that sin. We take comfort in the fact that your beloved Son was forsaken by you because of our sin and in our stead. Guide us to live in a manner worthy of our calling as redeemed people of God. In the precious name of Jesus we pray.
Amen.
You may be seated for our hymn, number 437. Against us, for our transgressions are with us, and we know our iniquities, transgressing and denying the Lord, and turning back and following our God, speaking oppression and revolt, conceiving and uttering from the heart lying words. Justice is turned back, and righteousness stands afar off, for truth has stumbled in the public squares, and uprightness cannot enter. Truth is lacking, and he who departs from evil makes himself a prey. The Lord saw it, and it displeased him, that there was no justice. He saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no one to intercede. Then his own arm brought to him salvation, and his righteousness upheld him. He put on righteousness as a breastplate, and a helmet of salvation on his head. He put on garments of vengeance for clothing, and wrapped himself in zeal as a cloak. O Lord, have mercy on us.
Thanks be to God.
speak responsibly Psalm 103. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice.
Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my peace and mercy.
If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who can stand? St. Matthew, the 27th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Now from the sixth hour there was darkness over all the land until the ninth hour. And about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, saying, Eli, Eli, lema sabachthani, that is, my God, why have you forsaken me? And some of the bystanders, hearing it, said, this man is calling Elijah. And one of them at once ran and took a sponge, filled it with sour wine, put it on a reed and gave it to him to drink. But the other said, wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
You may be seated for our sermon hymn.
Thank you.
baby deserted. A wife abandoned by her husband as he runs off. A child is left to fend for himself. Debt befalls a business partnership as one party is left to pay the bills. An elderly parent is all but forgotten by her children and grandchildren, who rarely call her or visit her. Each of us recoils from scenarios as these. We come to trust certain people in our lives, parents, children, spouses, teammates. But when they fail us and forsake us, we are grieved. There's no hurt greater than that of being abandoned by one you love and trust. Jesus Christ knew what it meant to be forsaken. He felt the sorrow and the heartbreak that it spawned. As the prophet Isaiah foretold, he was despised and rejected by men, a man of sorrows, an acquainted with grief. And as one from whom men hide their faces, he was despised, and we esteemed him not. First, Jesus was rejected by his own people, the nation of Israel. 5 days after Palm Sunday, when the crowd shouted to him, "Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord," they cry out for his death. "Let him be crucified." His own people handed him over to the enemy, to Rome, for execution. Second, Christ was rejected by the religious leaders of his day. The priests, scribes, and Pharisees initiated and executed his prosecution. The religious community, which should have been the first to acclaim him as the Messiah, was the first to disown him. Worse, even his friends abandoned him. When trouble arose, they ran and they scattered. One of Jesus' chosen 12 chose to betray him. Even his inner circle of friends dispersed when Jesus was arrested. Peter, who had earlier promised to defend Jesus to the death, instead denied any association with him. Those who had been followers disassociated themselves with him. The Lord was abandoned by his closest friends. As Jesus hung dying on the cross on that gruesome Friday afternoon, even the light of the sun deserted him. Verse 45 of our text states that darkness covered the land from noon till 3. Light itself fled from the one who claimed to be the light of the world. To add insult to injury, even justice abandoned Christ. He was on the cross, but he didn't deserve to be. The Roman governor Pontius Pilate had declared that Jesus was without guilt. The wicked King Herod acquitted Jesus of the charges against him. Yet there he hung, suffering as the worst of criminals. Justice was nowhere to be seen. It was absent. The absence of justice was demonstrated in the response of the bystanders to Jesus' cry from the cross, "Eli, Eli." Verse 47, Matthew 27 states, some of the bystanders hearing it said, "This man is calling Elijah." See, they mistook Jesus' call to God. Eli means "my God" in Aramaic, for a summons to Elijah, the prophet. Their mistakes stem from a pious superstition in the first century that held that a person who was being unjustly punished could call out to Elijah for vindication. If the person was truly innocent, it was popular belief, Elijah in heaven would intervene to see to the victim's deliverance. This is why in verse 49 of our text it states, "But the others said, 'Wait, let us see whether Elijah will come to save him.'" In other words, in the eyes of the people, Elijah was the personification of justice. The fact that Elijah didn't rescue Jesus from the cross simply attested that Jesus was abandoned by justice itself. Yes, Jesus was abandoned. He was abandoned by his nation, the religious establishment, and even his friends. As he hung dying, Jesus was forsaken by the created order itself, as the sun withdrew its light from him and justice turned aside from him. But these forms of abandonment pale in comparison to the ultimate abandonment that was being abandoned by God the Father. Father. That was the experience of being forsaken by God. That was the final form of forsakenness Jesus experienced. It was the most painful of all. During this Lenten season, we reflected upon the statements of Jesus spoke from the cross, his cross words. We've considered his final words uttered before his death. All of the statements express some aspect of Christ's final mission, but none express more powerfully and poignantly the horror of this mission than the words we consider today. They are recorded in the original Aramaic form in which Jesus spoke them. Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani. The gospel writer proceeds to translate the meaning, my God, why have you forsaken me? It is at this place and time that Jesus experienced forsakenness from his heavenly Father. It's possible that there have been times in which you and I have felt abandoned by God. Perhaps it was during a period of sorrow and loss. Maybe it was while you underwent grief and pain. We experience utter despair as we believe we are forsaken by God. Many of the Psalms speak to this feeling of abandonment. Even though we feel abandoned, we truly are not. God remains with us. We just don't recognize it. But that's not the way it was with Jesus. Not only did he feel abandoned by God as he gasped for his final breath, he actually was and truly was abandoned by the Father. He really was forsaken by God the Father. But why? What is the reason for this most extreme separation? The answer is that it's all because of us. Jesus is deserted by the Father because we had first deserted God. How have we done that? It's by our sin, through our sinful rebellion against God's will. It's our sin that caused the original separation from God. The prophet Isaiah explains the situation plainly. Your iniquities have made a separation between you and your God, and your sins have hidden his face from you so that he does not hear. The original alienation was initiated by us. Our first parents forsook God to go their own way, and their descendants have been following suit ever since. And that includes each of us today. Each of us has deserted God through our sin. And the punishment for such desertion is separation from God now and in eternity. The ultimate separation from God is hell itself, an eternal place of God forsaken. But Jesus has come to bear our sin and its punishment. The prophet declares, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity of us all. This is why Jesus was forsaken by his Father. It's because he bore our sin in his body on the cross. On that Friday afternoon when the sun turned dark, all the darkness of sin from all people of all time gathered upon Jesus. He bore our iniquity as he hung teeming with our sins. And the holy face of his Father turned from such unholy sin. The pure light of God's righteousness was repelled by the darkness of our depravity that was laid upon Christ on the cross. Because he bore our sin, Jesus became anathema to his Father. Or as the Apostle Paul puts it, Christ became a curse for us. Or it is written, cursed is everyone who is hanged on a tree. At that moment, one of the greatest mysteries of all time took place. God the Son was forsaken by God the Father. This doesn't mean that the Trinity was dissolved. The Godhead remained intact. By some mysterious means which we cannot fully understand, Jesus was forsaken by his Father. At that point of dereliction, Jesus experienced hell. He tasted hell, absolute alienation from the Father. He tasted hell for everyone. In an instant, the Eternal One endured an eternity of damnation in order to free those destined for hell. Jesus did this for all of you. He did it so that you would not be cursed by God. He did it so that you need not be separated from the Father because of your sin. He experienced the forsakenness of God so that you and I might never be forsaken. Paul explains, Christ redeemed us from the curse of the law by becoming a curse for us. And God made Christ, who had no sin, to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Also, that you and I might be restored to a right relationship with God by the removal of our sin. Immediately after Jesus died, a remarkable phenomenon occurred. Matthew's gospel reports that the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. And what was that curtain for? It showed the separation between the holy God and unholy people. Unholy people could not pass through the curtain. The curtain served as a barrier between God and sinners. But once Jesus died, the sin of all people was paid for. Thus, the barrier separating them from God was no longer needed. Accordingly, the curtain was torn from top to bottom, opening the way to God. There was no longer any separation between God and humanity. My God, why have you forsaken me? These words were spoken by Jesus so that you need never be forsaken by God. You need never fear abandonment from your heavenly Father. Jesus bore your alienation from God. He endured the God-forsakenness that you deserve. He was abandoned by the Father so that you may never be separated from him. And we can confidently assert with the Apostle Paul, for I am sure that neither death nor life, nor angels nor rulers, nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Jesus was forsaken by God so that you might be secure with God. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue worship at this time by gathering our tithes and our offerings. Once again, we welcome you to St. John on this day. We invite you to fill out the attendance cards down in the back of the pews, letting us know you're here. You can place those cards in the offering. invite you to please stand for prayer. We pray. Merciful God, we humbly implore you to cast your light upon your church, that we, being instructed by the doctrine of the blessed apostles, may walk in the light of your truth, and finally attain to the light of everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, we pray for our church, the Lutheran Church of Missouri City. Bless our synodical and district presidents as they lead and guide the church in its mission to witness to the world that in Christ you have reconciled us to yourself. Grant that by your Holy Spirit we may proclaim the good news of your salvation, so all who hear it may receive the gifts of salvation. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Sovereign Lord, keep the name of this nation under your care. Bless the current leaders of our land, especially our president, governor, mayor, and all other governmental leaders. Grant that they may be trustworthy and high in purpose, wise in counsel, and firm in justice, that under them we may be governed quietly and peacefully. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
prayer. O Lord, visit the homes and families in which your people dwell, and keep all harm and danger far from them. Grant that we may dwell together in peace under the protection of your holy angels, sharing eternally in your blessings. We pray for our ministries here at St. John, especially Little League, St. John Lutheran School, and also we lift up to you Lutheran High School. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our
prayer. O Lord Christ, you who are the strength of the weak and the consolation of those who are in distress, we mercifully lift up to you all who are sick or injured. We especially pray for Landon, for Mia, for Carla, as they all recover from hospital stays. We pray for these and all others whom we name in our hearts. We relieve them of all pain and anxiety, and grant them patience during these difficult times. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful God, in this earthly life, we endure trials and temptations of all kinds. We especially lift up to you Randy and Tracy House as they mourn the death of their daughter. Lead them and all others to trust you during these times that you have redeemed all suffering for your own purposes and making us ever more like Christ. Grant us grace at all times to subject ourselves to your holy will and to continue steadfast in the true faith that we may know the peace and joy, the blessed hope of the resurrection of the dead, and the glory of the world to come. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, from whom come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just words, give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments, and also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Taught by our Lord and trusting his promises, we are bold to pray. Our
Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
I thank you, my heavenly Father,
through Jesus Christ, your dear Son, that you have graciously kept me this day, and I pray that you would forgive me all my sins, for I have done wrong, and graciously keep me this night. For into your hands I commend myself, my body and soul, and all things. Let your holy angel be with me, that the evil foe may have no power over me. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
God.
The Almighty and merciful Lord, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless and preserve you.